Is 6 hours enough time for me to put in the shipping department?
Yes. It's a lot of hours.
This might be a good time to start talking about some sort of compensation for me.
What kind?
Money! Okay, I didn't mean it. I'm gonna put the labels on now.
Thank you.
What you making?
Cherry.
Cherry what?
Cherry lollipops.
Cherry pie?
It smells like cherry pie.
All right, black cherry lollipops.
Yeah. Thank you guys for ordering all your orders. I really appreciate it.
It's 10 p.m. When I decided to be in charge of the shipping department, especially today, I didn't expect. I've literally put about 7 hours, 6 or 7, what was all that light action I just saw? 7 hours into sparkly shipping today? Holy crap. I'm gonna take this to the main post office. It's nice and cool in there, all right? Plus, I think you probably save a day when you drop it off there instead of the one close by. Let's go. It's moments like these where you really begin to realize that life is not fair. I don't understand what the hell is wrong with this thing. I can see through the crack. There appears to be plenty of room. And that door keeps opening by itself. Is this place haunted or what? I guess I can't. Fuck. So I gotta drag these shits all the way back home, put them inside, because I want them to stay as cool as possible, because we don't want them to melt. There's nowhere else to put anything, right? This is bullshit. Oh, it does say 9 p.m. Monday through Friday until 9 p.m. because I came in here at 8:30 the other night and all this was operational. Doors were open. I can't believe I got to drag this shit all the way back home now. Oh, gosh. Well, that blows, but that's life. What are we gonna do? Look at the strip back there. Ain't she pretty? She's pretty. All right, I'm gonna tell you a secret. It's like 10:30 at night right now, and I haven't eaten food yet today. I had a couple little things that were like, I had a little half a piece of bread thing from the bakery or whatever, but I haven't had any food, and I'm about to melt down because I kept thinking that I was gonna get out, I'll eat soon. I kept putting it off and now here we are. So what are we gonna do? Holy shit. And I don't want to keep these things out in the heat. Even though they're double thermal wrapped, I don't want to leave them in the car. Gosh, we'll figure it out. Let's go. Damn, post office, James C. Brown Jr. facility. James C. Brown, your post office sucks. Point, I could legit start crying. Google says Pizza Rock is open until 12. It's like 11:10. The doors are locked and the lights are off. So no Pizza Rock. This day is turning out to be quite a letdown. So I tried really hard to find something interesting to eat. That was a fail. So I gotta eat something uninteresting. So what's the best way to make something uninteresting interesting? Well, this is the old Jack in the Box. The Jack in the Box that I used to eat at. I used to order from here all the time when I lived at Desert Manor. Remember the Desert Manor days? Now, Jack in the Box is pretty dangerous. In fact, every single time I order from Jack in the Box, I feel sick afterwards. And of course, the guy who gave me the food looked like he was high as a kite. And of course, we have no napkins, not a single. Not a single napkin. I felt some water. All right, already knowing that I'm gonna probably feel sick when I'm done. Rolling up into the drive-thru and seeing these on the menu. Is it? I think it's actually starting to rain. Look at this ridiculousness right here. Spicy tiny tacos, not just spicy tiny tacos, but loaded spicy tiny tacos. What is going on? So all this, look at these little guys. Oh shit, it's on my car. Now it's on the car. Hey, that tastes really good, but you know what else it tastes like? It tastes like I'm gonna die. No fork, no napkin, no nothing. Look, this calls for a fork, Jack in the Box. Where's that big ass head, Jack, when you need him? Somehow, that tastes really good, and they're spicy as hell. This is ridiculous. This is the most ridiculous vlog in the history of the Trooper vlog ever. Tiny ass tacos. Look at that. So I was thinking about, I don't have no napkins, so this is just gonna be everywhere. So I was thinking about all this candy action we got going. How weird is it that we've come full circle and I am now back in the eighth grade? because in the eighth grade, I was the sugar pusher. All right? I was the danger. I was the danger in eighth grade. Nerds, Pop Rocks, Blow Pops, other little weird square lollipops I used to get a hold of. Sour Patch Kids? Are you kidding me? If you wanted Sour Patch Kids, you had to go through me in the eighth grade. All right, you could probably just go to the corner store, but you had to go through me. Me and Just for Fun, man, we had that shit locked down. This shit. Jack in the Box is not a safe play. Oh, Lord. Here's the good news. I think it's gonna rain. I'm never gonna understand Jack in the Box burgers. The shit is always dripping off of it. Always dripping off of it. Drip, drip, dripping. The sauce. Look at it. Look at it. Drip. Go ahead. Do it. It really started in seventh grade. In seventh grade, I used to sell pencils and I used to dub cassette tapes. Fat Boys, Run DMC. I mean, we're talking about highly illegal stuff here. Copyright action. But it was in eighth grade that I realized what the people really wanted. Who were the people? The other kids in school. And what did they want? Candy. I'm gonna tell you right now, I don't know how these are so good. I have no idea. I have no idea how they're so hot inside. But I'm digging some damn loaded spicy mini tacos. I'm digging them so much, in fact, I might have to hit that drive-thru window again. I don't remember all of the details about selling candy in eighth grade, but the main details I do remember. Number one, it was illegal. Not with the law, but with the rules of the school. That rhymes. You weren't allowed to sell anything at school, let alone candy. Oh shit, these dudes just took a lift, took an Uber or a Lyft or whatever to Jack in the Box, and the doors are locked. They're about to be highly pissed off. Yep. They went around the other doors. They're locked. Now they're going, now what do we do? So it was illegal. It was against the rules to sell shit. I also remember that the science teacher, Mr. Parker, I'll never forget Mr. Parker. Mr. Parker was the damn narc agent. But see, even though Mr. Parker was hot on our tail all the time, Mr. Parker was the coolest teacher that I ever had, all the way through. Now, Mr. Parker was a really cool teacher. Whenever we would get caught with candy that we were selling, he wouldn't like write us up. He wouldn't like give us any real punishment. What he would do is the thing that hit us the hardest. He would confiscate the candy. Then he would give that candy away piece by piece in class. Maybe you answered a question correctly out loud. So I had to get creative. I would come to school with a big ass coat on and it would be lined with Blow Pops and these weird square suckers they used to have. I would have, I don't even remember all the shit I used to do. We had tall skinny lockers that went to the floor, not the ones that are stacked on top of each other. It was the old high school, so it was old ass lockers. They were tall and skinny all the way to the floor. And one day I brought an adjustable wrench to school because the hook in the middle, there was a shelf up top and there was a hook, and that hook was like to hang the jacket on, but it also had two hooks on the side. And I, for some reason, wanted to remove that hook. I don't remember. I don't even know if it had to do with candy, but I was like steadily in my locker like this right here looking for Mr. Parker because he was my homeroom teacher. So my locker was right outside his door, and I'm over here taking this damn thing off, damn adjustable wrench. I'm looking for Mr. Parker, and I'm looking for Mr. Parker, and then all of a sudden, I look this way, and there he was. His face was right here. He was just like watching me take the whole thing off. My assumption is that he wanted me to remove the entire thing and then make me put it back on. So he was just watching, 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 and no lie, in eighth grade without skipping a beat. I'm going unloosen, loosen, loosen. As soon as I see him, I just start tightening it back up. I don't remember saying a word. I just started putting it back on. Once I got it tightened back up, I was just about to close the locker and he put his hand in the door and he was like, hold on 1 second. And he like looked around like this right here, like this right here. And then he reached in and he grabbed this Army canteen case, like that you put on your belt that your canteen would go in. He picks it up, turns it upside down, candy all over the floor in the hallway. People are scrambling for the candy, trying to get the candy or whatever. It was crazy. It was crazy, Mr. Parker. Even with our losses to Mr. Parker, even with all the candy he confiscated and gave away in classes, we still made a fortune. For an eighth grader, a damn fortune. And we were very savvy. There was a department store in Landrum, South Carolina. It was called TG&Y. It was called TG&Y. TG&Y was going out of business. So everything in the store was marked down super cheap, including the candy. So we went there to get our candy for a cheaper price so that we could make more profit, so that our margins went through the roof. That, in fact, that TG&Y is where we first discovered Sour Patch Kids. And we were getting Pop Rocks from there, right? And I was getting candy from Sam's Club on Saturdays when my grandparents would go shopping for the week. I would tag along and I would buy a big ass tub of suckers for $6. And when I sold them for 25 cents each, it yielded $36. Huh? What? Eighth grader? Making that kind of jack? I was a damn little genius, okay? Still am. Oh yeah, I'm okay. I did eat. Who this?
Shit. Hello?
Don't curse on the vlog.
Oops.
Ha! I ate something really healthy. I decided to get something super healthy.
You finally got a salad?
Yep, I got a salad. It's a loaded spicy mini taco salad and an ultimate cheeseburger salad from Jack in the Box.
Oh my gosh.
Goodbye.
Terrible.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
I mean, look, this is Lady Trooper's operation. Sparkly Pops is all about Lady Trooper, okay? Look at this situation on my damn car. I hope it rains.
I mean, this is my sacrifice to you guys right now. My damn car
has got ketchup, mustard, and mayo all over that bitch. But I just thought it would be cool to come over here to the Jack in the Box that I used to go through the drive-thru all the time when I lived at Desert Manor. This is the one where I saw that lady one time. She was walking through here pushing a damn shopping cart. She was homeless. Her foot, she didn't have a shoe on one of her feet. It was all wrapped up in gauze or whatever. She was limping. It was hot as hell outside. She had like a shopping cart full of trash. And I just felt really bad for her. I gave her a bunch of bottles of water and I gave her a little bit of cash. And you know, I don't believe in giving cash to people on the street because generally speaking, it's not the best way to help them. The best way to help people on the street is to give to charities, give to shelters and organizations that help them. But this little lady, I was just like, I felt so bad. I couldn't just not give her. This is also the Jack in the Box where that dude appeared out of nowhere. And it freaked me out. I'm talking about, I pulled up to the damn window. You may remember this story. I pulled up to the drive-thru window. There's nobody around. It's just me and the girl in the window. And then I don't know if I looked at my radio and looked back up, but I couldn't have looked too far. I'm sitting right there in the car. My headlights are on. There's no one in front of me. And out of nowhere, this dude just appeared right by my damn mirror. He legit looked like a madman from a movie. That's the way he looked, completely disheveled. His hair was long, it was sticking up and out all over the place. I mean, he looked like he had been in a wind tunnel, you know, like it looked like a cartoon or something. Dude was all dirty, face was all dirty, beard everywhere. You probably would have been scared out of your pants if you looked up and he was standing right there in your window. I'm telling you, this dude looks scary. I was startled for a half a second because I was like, where did this dude come from? But when he spoke, it was more shocking than how he looked was how he spoke. Because when he spoke, it sounded so unexpected. It sounded nothing like what I was looking at. If you were on the phone or if your eyes were closed, you would have thought like that this was just like a gentle, normal situation. The man didn't ask me for a penny. He only asked me for coffee. Now because there are people on the street everywhere in Vegas, I'm talking about every damn corner. Like there have been 7 or 8 walk by here just in this little bit of time I've been out here. And because they're everywhere and I can't afford to help every single person, if I gave everyone who asked me for something $1 every day, I would be broke. So my default answer was, I don't have it, or I don't have anything, or whatever. So I went to my default answer and I did it very quickly. And then he just, I don't even remember if he said anything, but he just gently turned and walked away. Well, they were finishing up my order and I watched him in the rearview mirror to see which way he went, because I instantly felt like I should have given that guy a coffee. I should have ordered him a coffee right then and there. So what I did was, they gave me my bag and I made the right out of the damn thing really fast, and the light turned green and I went across the street where he was. He was over there behind Taco Rico. And I pulled up and I was like, yo, I'm sorry, I do want to get you a coffee. And I said, wait right here, I'm gonna go back through the drive-thru and bring you a coffee. I drove back over here, I ordered a large coffee. I got her to give me a bunch of cream and sugar. She gave it to me like in a bag or whatever on the side. And I went back over there and I pulled up and I gave the dude a coffee. And I'm gonna be honest with you, I can't remember if it was $2 or $5. I think I gave him $5, but I was like, here, get a coffee tomorrow. And I don't know, I think it touched me because he wanted coffee. He didn't ask me for money. He didn't ask me for money at all. He didn't even ask me for food. All he wanted was coffee. And I think a large coffee is like $1.29 or something. And it was just like, I don't know, that hit me hard. Probably because I'm a coffee addict. This dude doesn't look like your standard coffee dude or whatever. This dude is just a dude on the streets, but I don't know, I felt for him. And all he wanted was coffee. So I gave him coffee and I gave him money for a coffee the next day. I'll never forget that man and I'll never forget that lady. And you know, I told my mom about one of those stories, but I don't remember which one. And she told me about a verse from the Bible, Hebrews 13:2. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. In a more modern English, do not neglect hospitality to strangers, for by this some have entertained angels without knowing it. I had an eerie feeling the minute that dude appeared out of nowhere, and he was just there, and he wanted coffee. I'll put it to you this way. I'm not making any statements about my beliefs about that night, but I will say that if there has ever been a time that I was tested by an angel, it was the dude who wanted coffee at Jack in the Box. Telling you. Yo, remember, if you like my videos, click the thumbs up button, make sure you subscribe, tell your friends about the videos, leave a comment down below. I'm gonna see you next time, like it or not. See you next time. Thank you.